Thank you, Linda. That was inspiring. I'm all inspired now. It's the 4th of July tomorrow. Thank you. Welcome, everyone, both of you joining me here and those who are live streaming. Welcome to July 3rd worship at 8:30 a.m. Glad you all remembered and got here on time. My name's Chuck Anderson. I'll be assisting pastor this morning. Why don't you stand up, greet one another, just to say hello. Very good, very good. So we're going to start worship with one of my favorite hymns, Lift High the Cross. And if you get wild and crazy and you wanted to lift high, it would be okay, just so you know. Lift High the Cross, hymn 837, verses 1 through 4. Worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching Him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord. Almighty God, our Maker and Redeemer, we poor sinners confess unto you that we are by nature sinful and unclean, that we have sinned against you by thought, word, and deed. Wherefore we flee for refuge to your infinite mercy, seeking and imploring your grace for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. O most merciful God, who has given your only begotten Son to die for us, have mercy upon us, and for his sake, grant us remission of all of our sins. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, has had mercy upon us and has given his only Son to die for us, and for his sake forgiven us all of our sins. To those who believe on his name, he gives power to become the children of God and has promised them his Holy Spirit. He that believes and is baptized shall be saved. Grant this, Lord, unto us all. Amen. You may be seated. We continue with our hymn, I Am Trusting Thee, Lord Jesus. Old Testament lesson today is taken from Jeremiah chapter 29, beginning with verse 1. This is the text of the letter that the prophet Jeremiah sent from Jerusalem to the surviving elders among the exiles and to the priests and the prophets and all the other people Nebuchadnezzar has carried away into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says to all those I carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Build houses and settle down, plant gardens and eat what they produce. Marry and have sons and daughters. Find wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage so that they too may have sons and daughters. Increase in number there, do not decrease. Also seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you will prosper. This is the word of the Lord. We have two epistle lessons this morning. The first is from Romans 13, verse 1 through 7. Let everyone be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except that which God has established. The authorities that exist have been established by God. Consequently, whoever rebels against the authority is rebelling against what God has instituted, and those who do so will bring judgment on themselves. For rulers hold no terror for those who do right, but for those who do wrong. Do you want to be free from fear of one in authority? Then do what is right, and you will be commended. For the one in authority is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for rulers do not bear the sword for no reason. They are God's servants, agents of wrath to bring punishment on the wrongdoer. Therefore, it is necessary to submit to the authorities, not only because of possible punishment, but also as a matter of conscience. This is also why you pay taxes, for the authorities are God's servants who give their full time to governing. Give to everyone what you owe them. If you owe taxes, pay taxes. If revenue, then revenue. If respect, then respect. If honor, then honor. Let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another. For whoever loves others has fulfilled the law. This is the word of the Lord. And the second epistle lesson is from Acts 5, beginning with verse 27. The apostles were brought in and made to appear before the Sanhedrin to be questioned by the high priest. This was after Jesus had gone and they had been preaching, and the Jewish Sanhedrin didn't like it. So the apostles were brought in and made to appear before the Sanhedrin to be questioned by the high priest. We gave you strict orders not to teach in this name, he said. Yet you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching and are determined to make us guilty of this man's blood. Peter and the other apostles replied, we must obey God rather than human beings. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Okay, pastor's going to do the children's lesson. If you want to come on down, he'll chat with you.
Hey, how you doing? Good to see you. Hi. So I brought a couple of things today. I brought a light bulb, and I brought some salt. Kind of crazy. Why would I bring a light bulb and some salt? I mean, this morning, early in the morning, I'm looking for this stuff, and I put it in it. Why would I do that? Light bulb and salt. Jesus said, I want you to be the light of the world and the salt of the earth. You know, this is the 4th of July weekend, right? We celebrate the gift our nation is to us and the fact that we're free. And in all of our world, and it starts in our nation, Jesus wants us to be light. What that means is he is called the light of the world. And we're light when we love in his name and when we tell folks about him, right? We bring light into the world, into our nation. We love our nation. That's what we do. And this salt stuff, how can we be the salt? Have you ever noticed that stuff tastes better with salt, like French fries? Oh, I'm sure you eat French fries. Let me see. Lots of stuff tastes better with salt, right? And so we bring the pizzazz of Jesus into the world. Everything tastes better when we love people in his name and when we bring his light into the world. Especially, that's how we serve everybody in this wonderful nation that he's given us. So I'm going to teach you a song to remember that, okay? It goes like, let's stand up. Here we go. It goes like this. This little gospel, okay, what's the gospel? It's the good news about Jesus. It's the light and salt in the world, all right? So, this little gospel light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Let's do that much, ready? This little gospel light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. And we do that again. This little gospel light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Then we do it again. This little gospel light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Then it goes like this. Let it shine all the time. Let it shine. Okay, can we do that? All right. You got your gospel light out? You got your Jesus light out? Got your Jesus light out? This is the light of the world that we bring, and it's the salt of the earth because it brings pizzazz. His love brings pizzazz. Here we go. Ready? This little gospel light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little gospel light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little gospel light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine all the time, let it shine. Now it's all around the neighborhood, okay? Ready, one, two, three. All around the neighborhood, I'm gonna let it shine. All around the neighborhood, I'm gonna let it shine. All around the neighborhood, I'm gonna let it shine all the time. Let it shine. I blew that, didn't I? But we'll get it right this time, okay? No one's gonna it out. Here we go, ready? Nobody's gonna it out. I'm gonna let it shine. Don't you try to it out. I'm gonna let it shine. Don't you try to it out. I'm gonna let it shine all the time, let it shine. That's what we want to do every day in our community, in our nation. That's how we show people that we love them, and that's why we help people in this nation that God's given us, okay? We bring the light of Jesus, we bring his love, and that's the pizzazz. All right, we'll see you next time. We got children's right outside the door here with Jen. By the way, there's a survey to take at the desk today, and also there's some sign-ups if you'd like to serve with the children's ministry.
The gospel, I'm very loud. Gospel according to St. Mark, chapter 12, beginning with verse 13. Later, they sent some of the Pharisees and the Herodians to Jesus to catch him in his words. They came to him and said, "Teacher, we know that you are a man of integrity. You aren't swayed by others because you pay no attention to who they are. But you teach the way of God in accordance with the truth. Is it right to pay the imperial tax to Caesar or not? Should we pay or shouldn't we?" But Jesus knew their hypocrisy. "Why are you trying to trap me?" he asked them. "Bring me a denarius and let me look at it." They brought him the coin, and he asked them, "Whose image is this and whose inscription?" "Caesar's," they replied. Then Jesus said, "Give back to Caesar what is Caesar's and to God what is God's." They were amazed at him. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated as we sing our hymn, "Lord, Take My Hand and Lead Me," hymn 722.
Your grace.
grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father, from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Grace and peace to each of you who are here. Grace and peace to each of you who are joining us online. We pray that God's Spirit would bless each of you. He's not confined by space and time. His Spirit, through His Word, touches our hearts, gives us the love of Jesus and wisdom to live in our time. Amen. So, Elephant in the Room, that's our series. For those of you who wonder what's going on, we don't worship elephants, honest. But the idea here was the elephant in the room are those questions that we want to ask, but we don't, because it makes us uncomfortable. And so for the last 6 weeks or so, we've asked for those questions from you. And today, in the 4th of July weekend, we group some of those that are saying, how can we make changes in our world, in our nation? Because that's how I looked at a lot of these questions. And so that's what we're going to look at today, that elephant in the room, these elephant in the room questions. Thought about this, and I remember I was a senior in high school, and I was having lunch with three or four guys. We could get off campus by then, and we were at this burrito, 50 cents for a bean and cheese burrito. It was awesome. Man, we could eat those all week, right? 50 cents for this huge bean and cheese burrito. And so we were sitting there, and the Vietnam War was kind of winding down, but it wasn't done, and no one was sure when it was going to end. And so what we were talking about is somebody brought up, hey, what are you going to do if you get drafted? And I don't mean to offend anyone, but by that time, no one really agreed with the Vietnam War, okay, for a lot of reasons. But we were talking about that, and I said, you know, I would go in just because it's how I was raised. And I was just and we were looking all, and there was this guy that was sitting at another table, three or four guys, and he heard me say that. And he jumped up, and he was about half my size, which is saying something, because I'm not very tall, right? But he's about half my size, and he starts screaming at the top of his lungs. Now, maybe he was like me, and he had somebody he looked up to that was killed in the war. Maybe he was like me, and he had a friend that came back with no legs. Maybe he had a brother that had died. I don't know. But he was freaking, and he started pushing me. I mean, it's like a little rat terrier with a German shepherd, you know? I mean, he was pushing me, and I'm looking at his friend saying, you know, I'm kind of holding him off like this, and I'm looking at his friend saying, you got to help me here. He was absolutely crazy. And they finally gathered him up. Sometimes I think we're still in that same place, only different issues, huh? Today we celebrate this wonderful nation that God has given us. I think every people on the face of the earth have a time when they celebrate the gift of their nation, huh? And we celebrate our friends and our families and our people, and we you know, from sea to shining sea is so wonderful. Have you ever done any travel? And we celebrate what we were founded on. This second paragraph. In the Declaration, it says that we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator. In other words, we get these from God, not from any government, from their Creator, with certain inalienable rights, that among them are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That to secure these rights, government are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed. You know how powerful these words are? It is awesome. And I rejoice at that. To be a part of a nation that this was the founding document. But we're still trying to live up to it, right? No one would say we're there yet. Last time I checked, there's not one politician who ran for office saying, I don't want to change a thing. We're perfect. And you read the history of our nation, and your heart breaks in so many ways that we didn't live up to these words, even as we acknowledge them and rejoice. Your questions struggle with these things, the things that aren't right, the things that make us at times irrational, like that young guy, didn't even know that wanted to go to war with me. Here are your questions. How can we stop the onslaught of hate speech, racism, lies being accepted as truth in the world, and anger, of course, it's on the increase. And it's funny, I asked some people the last couple of weeks about, I read this question to them, and they would hesitate. And I said, what are you hesitating about? They said, well, I don't know. You know what they're hesitating about as I talked to them? They were trying to figure out not whether this is right, but rather who spoke them. Because they were saying, hey, I'm going to decide whether I like this because if it's the group I'm for, if it's the group I think I'm going to get life from. It's not a matter of truth. It's a matter of power. Is that what Jesus said? I thought about that and these words from Corinthians. We looked at it last week. Love rejoices with it. Read the word. Truth. Doesn't matter who the truth comes from. It's amazing to me as I listen to pundits and people that talk, somebody will say something that is absolutely right, and it's a negative thing, and the other person will say, yeah, but, isn't truth truth? Isn't evil evil and good good? Isn't right right and wrong wrong, no matter where it comes from? You see, we're called to a different place. As I'm going to put up a screenshot, it says we don't get our life from anything on this earth. And it makes us free so we can stand for truth, always. It always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. It never fails, right? Here's some more of your questions. Having trouble reading that puppy. How do we turn the other cheek when we don't respect or agree with the elected officials or others in authority, when we feel they are not acting for the community good? And what do we say? Well, which officials are you talking about? Talking about the ones I agree with or not? Instead of saying, no, this is a question no matter where we stand and no matter how they are. It's like the kids, when I did confirmation, we say, honor your father and mother. And they say, well, what if they don't deserve it? And I say, it doesn't matter. They're your mom and dad, you honor them. Here's another one. Do we have a government problem or a morality problem in our country? Yes. Right? We're simple human beings, yes. Here's another one. I don't believe in masks and don't like wearing them. Now plug in here the other one too. I don't believe in not wearing masks, but whatever you want to do. What should be my biblical response to people who wear masks? And they kind of answer the questions. How do I apply love my neighbor and the concept of submission, being a servant? Great question, right? Plug it around now. And I think what's behind this is not simply I like masks, I don't like masks, but you know, this gotten crazy, this discussion, as if our national good depends on this or not. And which group says what, and then I'll know whether I'm for it or not. There were two disciples amongst the 12. One was called Simon the Zealot, and the other one called Matthew the tax collector. I thought about this week. Simon the Zealot, you know what the zealots were for? Violently overthrowing Rome. Let's go for it, baby. Give me a sword. Let's go for it. The zealots were always rebelling, right? Tax collectors. They were in league with Rome. They played ball with Rome. They thought Rome was good for the country. How did they ever live together amongst the 12? Because they lived by a different truth. A higher reality, a truth that transcended their disagreements. And they found common ground in living from that truth. Men, this last week we said the rules of the game are we start with the heart of God and never leave it. The Bible is God's word, it's truth, and we live in love. Those are the rules of the game throughout this series, right? So here we go with the first one, the heart of God. And with what we're talking about here, I think it goes to frame of mind. What's the heart of God? For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son. Whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Do you know Jesus? You know that in Jesus you have everything you need? There's a famous Christian, he said, apart from knowing Jesus, we are always looking and never finding. We are always trying to find what can fill us up, what can give us life, give us fulfillment. We're always looking and never finding if we don't have Jesus. Because, see, we were created only to be filled up, to be whole in relationship with God. I think sometimes we get that mixed up. And we get so drawn in to arguments and fights that we think that somehow on this earth we'll get filled up if my side wins. You've already won in Jesus Christ. You're already His. Even as I speak these words, the Spirit of God is touching your heart. And He's saying, in Jesus, you have everything, maybe for the first time. Maybe to renew you in that or grow you in that reality. And what we're talking about today, this goes to the frame of mind that in Jesus, we have everything. What did He say on the cross? It is finished. He rose and He gives us new life. Our baptism signifies that we died to sin and live brand new in Jesus. Where are we living as if that's not the case? As if we need something more. The Bible is it's amazing with this stuff. In Philippians it says, their minds, the people, folks that know Jesus, their minds on earthly stuff. They're trying to find their life with earthly stuff. They're trying to find their victory with earthly stuff. They're trying to be filled up with earthly stuff. It's not ever going to work. But our, look at that word. Would you read that third word? But our citizenship. Wow. Our citizenship is in heaven. And we eagerly await a Savior from there. Here's another one. For here we do not have an enduring city, but we are looking for a city that is to come. Here's another one. To God's elect, read the next word. Strangers in the world. Strangers in the world. Does that scare you? You see, we can be strangers in the world because we have everything we need in Jesus, because we are citizens of another nation. Old Testament, it talked about, this is so amazing. You know, the Old Testament, people think, okay, it's all about Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and God was going to give them and their descendants the promised land. They went to Egypt. They were in slavery. He rescued them. He brought them into the promised land, and that's the Old Testament, right? And Jesus was going to be born from that, but Abraham was looking forward to that land, the promised land. But this is what it says in Hebrews, for Abraham was like a stranger in a foreign country. He's talking about when he was in the Palestine, when he was in the land of Israel, right? He's like a stranger there, but he didn't care. Why? For he was looking forward to the city with foundations whose architect and builder is, read it, God. Where do you look? What city do you look forward? Where do you put your hope? We have this wonderful freedom. Jesus said he came that we might be free, right? You'll know the truth will set you free. This is the truth. You have everything you need in Him. You're part of His nation. You're part of His victory. You're part of a people that will go on forever. We're strangers here. But because of what we have, we're called empowered to serve. But you're a chosen people, it says in 1 Peter. Read the next. A royal priesthood, a holy, read it, nation. This is who we are. A people belonging to God. It goes to our frame of mind. Go ahead. Our salvation, our life, read the rest of it, does not come from any earthly government. Isn't that freedom? It doesn't matter. We are free in Jesus Christ. We have won in Jesus Christ. We're part of His nation. We're citizens of heaven. And that frees us to be servants. The book of Jeremiah, the people of God have been conquered by Babylon, and they've been they've been taken into captivity, all the leaders. Now we think about this stuff and we sanitize it. You know, it must have been horrible. I was reading a book that the Babylonians probably impaled many of the leaders and soldiers on sticks. They'd learned that from the Assyrians. So the last thing these people who were taken captive would remember as they were herded out of Jerusalem was this horrible sight. And yet this is what God says to the prophet. This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says to all those I carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Build houses and settle down. Seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. Yeah, we're strangers here. Our citizenship is in heaven. We have this wonderful gift of this nation from God, but we're strangers here. But because of that, we can live in a higher place, a place that calls us to service, a place where we can work for the peace and prosperity of the city. It's not about me anymore. I'm called to serve here. I'm called to speak the truth in love. I'm not called to go to war for something that I have to fight for so that I get filled up, so that I get what I want. You have the story of the Babylonians of Daniel and the three young men. They were all leaders in the government. They served the nation. Daniel was thrown in the lion's den because he was praying. What do you think he was praying about? You think maybe he was praying for the very nation that wanted to throw him into the lions? What does that say to us with these questions that we've looked at? If it's not about me and staking out a position so I get what I want. In Romans 13, it says, everyone must, now think about this with me. These are the first generation of Christians. What were going to happen to these guys? They were going to be persecuted. They were going to be murdered. Soon they would be thrown into the Colosseum, and wild animals would devour them. They or their descendants would be lit like torches on crosses to light up Rome. Everyone must submit himself to the governing authorities, not just because of possible punishment, but also because of conscience. Where's the conscience? Because of God's word. For there is no authority except which God has established. If you owe taxes, pay taxes. Boy, you want to get a fight around here, right? You want to get a fight around here? If you owe taxes, pay taxes, right? If revenue, then revenue. If respect, then respect. If honor, then honor. Do you think the Roman officials who put the Christians to death deserve their respect and honor? Or do you think they followed their conscience because God had said to respect and honor them? Jesus said, and this is great because the question was, hey, should we pay taxes to Rome or not? The question never, it's thousands of years later, we're still asking, we don't want to pay taxes, right? Give to Caesar's the things that are Caesar's and to God the things that are God's. Now, to give to Caesar the things that are Caesar's is kind of what we looked at in this Roman text and even in the Jeremiah text, right? We pray for our nation. We seek his peace and prosperity. We work for that. We're servants here. We honor and respect and give those things to the officials, whether they earn it or not. All of those things, give to Caesar the things that are Caesar's. But what does it mean to give to God the things that are God's? You know, oftentimes these days, I see in the rest of the New Testament after the Gospels, I see the writers taking sayings of Jesus and kind of writing stuff on them, and you can kind of see it. And you can kind of see it in this Roman text. Give to Caesar the things that are Caesar's. What does that mean? Well, you pay taxes, you give respect, and you give honor, you obey the laws. That's the Caesar's. But what is to give to God the things that are God's in this Roman text? It's the very next verse. Go ahead. It's this one. Let no debt remain outstanding. Read the rest of it. Except the continuing debt to love one another. That's given to God what's God's. It's not just living morally. It's loving our neighbor. Certainly speaking the truth, but always in love. This verse that was read, we must obey God rather than men. A lot of folks say, well, what that means is when people want us to go against the Bible and validate things that aren't right, we shouldn't do that, and that's true. But you know what the context? You got me? Do you know what the context is? The context is that they were telling other people about Jesus. You want to make a difference in our world? You want to make a difference in our nation? You know, the Old Testament people that were carried off into Babylon, that prayed for the nation, Meshach, Rashach, and Abednego, that prayed and were thrown into the fiery furnace. If you read the account there, the king put it out to all of the nations, which was all the then known world in that area, that the God of the Hebrews was the real God, and you're supposed to worship this one. You know what happened? The same thing happened with Daniel when he did the lion thing, right? And he was alive the next morning. The king said, hey, honor this one. All of those people came to know the true God. Centuries later, who came from there? The wise men. How do you think they knew to look for the star? The people suffered horribly. They were told to make a home in that nation and to seek its good and its prosperity and to pray for it. In the New Testament, we think we always have to have power today, but the first Christians had no power. But they prayed for their nations. And they loved. You know, then when there was plague in Rome, all of the wealthy Romans ran away. The Christians stayed and took care of the people. Many of them died there. You want to turn the world upside down? You want to turn our nation be a blessing in our nation and turn it upside down for the good? Certainly we stand for the truth, but we love. And we share this Jesus. You know, that's hard to have faith in that, isn't it? I had a good friend of mine once. He says, you know, he's a pastor, and he says, you know, the hardest thing is to have faith in the gospel. We always want to do stuff with our power. Instead of change the hearts of people, and through that, the world changes. That 1 Peter 1 that calls us a holy nation, it says, but you are a holy nation that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Where can you live in love? You know, I was just talking with one of our members, and she had been working with foster kids for a while, but with COVID and everything, that kind of went away. And she said, so now I'm delivering Meals on Wheels twice a week. And from the outside looking in, you say, oh, Meals on Wheels, what the heck? Or working with these kids that see if they go back to mom and dad. Come on, you think you're going to make a dent in anything? What can you do to show the love of Jesus to someone? Do you believe that when they see Jesus in you, it can change things? Like a giant ocean. As together, we certainly speak his truth in love, but we touch people in this ocean of love in his name. How can we stop the onslaught of hate speech, racism, lies being accepted as truth in the world? Anger is on the increase too. How can we turn the other cheek? How do we turn the other cheek when we don't respect or agree with the elected officials or others in authority? We feel they are not acting for the community good. Do we have a government problem or a morality problem in our country? I don't believe in masks and don't like wearing them. What should be my biblical response to people who wear masks? How do I apply my love my neighbor and the concept of servanthood? How do we change things? We live in the heart of God. Know that we're part of a different nation, that we're aliens, we're strangers here just passing through. Our salvation does not come from any nation or any government. Our life comes from God. We give to Caesar the things that are Caesar's. Respect, honor, we pay the taxes, we obey the laws. And we give to God the things that are God's. Let no debt remain outstanding except the debt of continuing in love. Would you pray with me? Dearest Jesus, sometimes we get caught up in the spirit of our times, the spirit of thinking that somehow our lives, our salvation, our very idea of our survival depends on something outside of you. Lord, we pray that your spirit would refresh us, this reality that we are yours, that we have victory in you, that we have everything in you, and that our nation is a nation that goes on forever. From this place, Lord, we pray that you might guide us in giving to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, but finally also, Lord, living in love, for this is your kingdom that we live and move and have our being in. And we pray, Lord, that you might give us your spirit so that we trust that finally change will come, will turn the world upside down, as we certainly stand for truth, but as we love in your name. Pray in your name. Amen. We stand, we confess our Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth.
Pilate was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead.
He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead.
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Lord of the church, pour out your spirit upon us and your whole church, that your people in every place may speak your words of hope in the pockets and places that you have planted us, that your message might get out and your kingdom might move forward. Lord, in your mercy, preserve the family and all godly Christian homes. Help parents demonstrate trust in you and teach the faith to their children. May our homes become beacons of your love and grace. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, mighty God, you sent your Son to shepherd his flock in strength. Grant wisdom to our leaders and peace among the nations. Lord, in your mercy. Lord Jesus, show your mercy to the sick and hospitalized. Especially we pray for Charlene and Marcia. May your angels surround them, guard and keep them. Hold them, Lord, in your gentle embrace. We ask that you bring healing, comfort, and peace to their bodies. Calm their fears and let them experience the healing power of your love. Let them recover their health and joyfully praise your name. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, we ask you to send your peace to all who are mourning, especially Maria and her family upon the loss of her husband John, for Dee and her family upon the loss of her brother Steve. Continue to surround them with family and friends and loved ones who offer words of comfort and love. Father, remove the spirit of heaviness and sadness that lives in the heart when losing someone deeply loved. As they take refuge in you, please help them also to put their trust in you, in your promise of life forever with you, the good news of joy, peace, and love beyond imagination. Lord, in your mercy. Loving Lord, we thank you for your provision and safely bringing our brothers and sisters from Hungary safely here this weekend. We pray your blessing on their visit, their mission work, the National Youth Gathering event, a memorable and soul-blessing visit, and safe travel home. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, renew us day by your Spirit, that we may follow you in all we do. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and lead us not into temptation, and lead us not into those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. As Sarah makes her way up here, I wanted to remind you that Bonnie will be here to pray with you after the worship service. And I don't know, Bonnie, are you going to be up front or in the back? Up front, okay. So I'd like to introduce you to Sarah, pastor's daughter, who lives in Hungary and is here to tell us a little bit about her mission work there.
Yes, thank you. You guys can be seated. It is so wonderful to be here today. I see a lot of familiar faces and unfamiliar faces, so I'm looking forward to meeting a lot of you. As was said, my name is Sarah. I am Pastor Brad's daughter. I've been serving as a missionary in Hungary for the last 13 years. And all of you at St. Matthew have been wonderful partners and a huge blessing to me and to my family as well. If you can look at the screen, you can see I put up a picture with a Bible verse that says, "How beautiful on the mountains are the feet of those who bring good news, who proclaim peace, who bring good tidings, who proclaim salvation." So here's the question. Where do your feet take you? Around the block, to your neighbor, across the world, like-minded, all the way to Hungary. I get to do these things there. You guys get to do these things here. And usually, we don't walk and do these things alone, right? I see a lot of you sitting next to people, or we're in a huge congregation of people, and we walk together, and we do these things together. And I'm so thankful for all of you that we can walk together and proclaim peace and proclaim salvation. Now, this morning, your feet have taken you here to church, to worship, and they will take you home. Again, hopefully. And on the way, you do these things. These people's feet in the picture also took them to worship, but not in America. It took them to worship in Dear Hungary, to our English language worship service. And actually, here in this picture, there are at least three nationalities represented. Ukrainian, Hungarian, and American. And it is a blessing to be able to worship all together as God's people. Now, look at your feet or your neighbor's feet, if that isn't strange for you. What shoes are you wearing? Something perhaps appropriate to the season? I myself had to put on some flip-flops this morning. It's a bit chilly out, but it does the job, right? at least two of the people in this picture didn't have appropriate footwear, because when they left and fled from Ukraine as refugees, it was winter. And they had boots. And they fled to Hungary in the springtime and had no appropriate shoes. And because of people like you and the ability that I had to be there and to help them, they now have appropriate footwear, shoes, for spring, shoes for summer, and not only that, they have a chance to hear the gospel every Sunday. Our English language worship has turned into a three-language worship service with translation into Hungarian and Ukrainian, and of course, worship in English. So it's a blessing to be able to not only meet physical needs, but more important than that, to proclaim peace and to proclaim salvation. And as my dad said, to touch people with an ocean of love. That was lovely, Dad. Great job. So as we have this ocean of love, I can touch people there, you can touch people here, and to proclaim this salvation and show this love. So I'm happy to be here. I'll be here most of the day today. If you would like to hear more about my work, not just with refugees, but also with students, a bunch of my students are here. We have 20 kids, a total of 24 people from Hungary going to the National Youth Gathering. It's amazing. You can go meet them too. They're wonderful. If you'd like to hear more about my work with them and with kids and with families, here in this room at 11:30, I will be giving a presentation. So I'd love to see you there and meet you and talk to you more. Also, I have some prayer cards. I think I'm going to leave at the welcome station.
Okay.
Yeah, at the welcome station, so you can grab one of those if you'd like. And as we touch people with an ocean of love and proclaim peace and salvation together. So thank you.
Some of you may not know that your blessing of offering has impacted Sarah's life and also the life of those that she's ministering to. Because of your generosity, we were able to send $10,000 to help with the Ukrainian crisis. And that's a little bit about what Sarah was starting to talk about there is because of her connections inside the Ukraine and those she knows and are close to, we were able to directly impact the refugees escaping from Ukraine and the war through your offerings. It was a great joy to meet for us to be able to extend that love and peace and clothe and feed and all those things that Jesus talks about us doing for him by doing for others. So thank you for your generosity. You know there's three ways to give. The offering box is on the way out online and by mail, of course. We will have Pastor give closing comments and announcements and close our patriotic closing hymn.
Just a couple of announcements. Start thinking about the Makers Marketplace. It's coming up in the fall. There's information on the website for that, so you can start making your stuff. It's a great time here. And then also there's a bake sale from all of our kids, both our children, our young people, and the Hungarians. It's a kind of a fundraiser as they're leaving for the National Youth Gathering. As you leave today, there's a survey for parents to the left at the cubicle there. Also a way to sign up to be a servant in the children's ministry. So please stand. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God, the communion of the Holy Spirit be and abide with each of us always. Amen.
Oh,
today. Have a great week. Rejoice in this nation that God has given us to be a part of, and think about what it means to be a servant here, to love people in the name of Jesus. Those who are with me, there's also bags that you can grab for the needy, for the homeless. You can just keep them in your car. Those are on the right wall as you're walking in this direction. May God be with you this week.